register your votes. And that item passes 5-0. We'll move on to public comments. Anyone wishing to address the Planning Commission during the public comment section or on an agenda item is asked to complete a request to speak form available at the door with our planning secretary. The completed form is to be submitted to the Planning Commission secretary prior to an individual being heard by the Planning Commission. Any person wishing to address the Planning Commission on a subject other than those scheduled on the agenda is requested to do so at this time. In order to conduct a timely meeting, there will be a 3-minute time limit per person and an overall time limit of 15 minutes for the public comments portion of the agenda. State law prohibits the Planning Commission from taking any action on a specific item unless it appears on the posted agenda. Ms. Sharkey, are there any requests to speak forms? No. No. Okay, so consent calendar, there are no items on the consent calendar. So we move on to public hearings, and we have item 2 for coastal development permit CDP 15-0004 to allow the demolition of an existing single-family dwelling and construction of a new single-family dwelling on land located within the residential single-family 4, RSF 4 zoning district at 195 Monarch Bay Drive. Is there a staff report on item 2?
Yes, Associate Planner Evan Langen will give the staff reports for the next 3 items. Thank you.
I'm very tired of my voice by the end of the evening. And good evening, commissioners. I'm on your screens as the presentation for this item. As you mentioned, a CDP to allow the demolition of an existing single-family dwelling and the construction of a new one in its place. The subject property is located in the Monarch Bay Homeowners Association. That's a built-out community of exclusively single-family dwellings along PCH and the Pacific Ocean, or the coastline. The subject property, 195 Monarch Bay Drive, currently contains most of a single-family dwelling. Late last year, building permits were issued for a scope of work that did not trigger the requirement for a coastal development permit. And generally speaking, the trigger for any CDP is going to be new homes or substantial additions to existing homes, and in the city's so-called coastal overlay district, or the California Coastal Zone, as it's more commonly known. Building permits were issued for a scope of work, a small addition, extensive remodel, but nothing that rose to the level or hit the threshold for a coastal development permit. So those permits were issued. As you can see, work began, but did not continue on to its end. Work stopped, and the home laid in pretty well the condition that you see here for some time. When the owner decided to expand on that scope of work and effectively tear the house down and build a new one in its place. The site plan, again, a brand new home, although more or less sitting within the footprint of the current home, the home you just saw in the previous photographs. That home would be a maximum of 13 feet tall and comprise one story. I'll show you some elevations in just a moment. As part of the new home, I should say, there'll be the addition of new accessory structures, specifically a casita here in the roughly the top left of your screen, and which would provide or serve a new swimming pool. The casita would contain a bedroom and a bathroom, but no kitchen facilities. It's not proposed to be a second dwelling unit. It's just an accessory building. New exterior improvements, the aforementioned pool, spa, landscaping, and hardscape. Some color elevations. As I mentioned, single story, not more than 13 feet tall. Parking will be provided for 2 cars plus a 3rd space for a golf cart, so not a full-size garage space, but that's the smaller single door that you see here. The building complies with all development standards, setbacks from property lines, landscaping, lot coverage, again, height. The project was approved by the HOA. We have stamped plans on file, a little bit different. Usually we take in correspondence, but in the case of this project, we have a stamped set of plans showing the HOA's approval of the project as proposed. In summary, again, as the project is found to comply with all standards, and more specifically, as findings can be made to recommend for approval of the coastal development permit, staff accordingly does just that, recommends that you approve the project as proposed. And with that, if there are any questions, thank you.
Do the commissioners have any questions for staff? No? I have a question. So was the project red tagged and then, or they just decided to start over?
It wasn't red tagged per se, and that's a process to go through to actually red tag a building. It just lay fallow for the most part. So the permits were active but didn't receive inspections, of course, weren't finaled. The project wasn't completed, and so it pretty well just stayed, as you saw in the photographs, just sat there. And of course, those permits have since expired. New ones would need to be issued along with this larger scope of work for a brand new home. But no, the building wasn't officially red tagged. The owner just didn't complete the scope of work. Started but stopped.
Okay. Any other questions? Commissioner McCann?
Yes, I have a question. In the off the master suite in the front yard, there's a wall. It says private garden. How high is that wall? I saw a note somewhere that said 42-inch garden wall. Okay, so that there's not two parallel walls on a taller one.
No, they are.
Because there's a couple walls there, it looks like, but it could just be curbing or something.
No, actually, I believe they are tiered, but they, let's see. 42 inches is the height. I'm going to get some clarification from the applicant. I believe they are tiered. Is that correct? Yeah.
Sorry?
The garden walls in the front yard, they are
42 inches.
There are two, forgive me, there actually are two walls, one behind the other. Yes, each 42 inches.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, I have a
question.
Okay, yes. I have a question on, it says here that there is a accessory rooms, including study, office, a kid's room, okay, and a detached accessory structure that contains a single family bedroom, bathroom, and storage space is proposed in the rear yard. It says this, it will not be utilized as a secondary dwelling unit. Well, it seems to me that if you have a bathroom and a bedroom, okay, I don't consider that accessory. I consider that, I don't like people living in the backyard because I think that we've seen instances of this in other communities, but it gets too tempting. You get a 17-year-old kid that would love to live there, and then somebody puts grandma and grandpa in there, and then something happens. To me, this is not an accessory structure. Someone, I would assume if it's a bedroom, it's a full bedroom. It's clearly a bathroom. Mm-hmm. I don't know about the storage space.
The trigger to qualify the structure as living space, as a second dwelling unit, would be the addition of a kitchen or the inclusion of a kitchen in its floor plan. There are no proposals for hookups and certainly no dedicated kitchen by design as part of the floor plan. And so per the zoning code and per the building code for that matter, it's just a detached accessory structure. There's no restriction per se on putting bedroom space within an accessory structure. You can do that. It's just the addition of that kitchen that changes the nature of the use to one that can be rented out and used as a primary living area.
I mean, I understand that. I just have seen too many instances in which it starts out this way, and the space just being too tempting, it grows, and people do start living in there, generally elderly or generally your children. I know there was one, I don't remember exactly where in the city, but there was one where they had grandma, and she had built herself pretty much as good as what we've got and stuff. And then one night she had a stroke, and there was no access to the main residence. And I'm very fearful of that. And it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen overnight here. But over the course of years, these supposedly not real rooms start to get used. It's just too tempting.
But I would like to interject that actually under our housing element, we encourage folks to put kitchens into those secondary units if they're going to record affordability covenants on their properties. It's a way for us to comply with the low-income housing requirement that we are to meet ARENA numbers. So not in this particular situation, they are not trying to do that, but if somebody did want to put a kitchen in to make it a bona fide secondary dwelling unit and then put those covenants on the property, that is actually something that we encourage. So I just wanted to remind you all of that policy.
Okay, all right, that makes sense. But you're using it to take care of another issue that we have in the city. Okay, that makes some sense.
Any other questions for staff? Commissioner Murphy?
I noted that there are no variances.
No variances are requested for this plan.
Okay, and I don't think I had another question. Just, I was reviewing the findings from the resolution itself, and I think as I went through it, I understood it.
So, but I failed to review it before coming in here, so if I might step down for a moment and look at it while somebody else takes over.
Okay. I did have a question, kind of following up on Commissioner Claus. Now, let's say somebody did need, you know, emergency from, you know, fire or ambulance or whatever. I'm assuming, you know, a gurney or something can get through the side yard or, you know, to get to that rear access. Okay. All right. Seeing that we don't have any more questions of staff, do we have any requests to speak forms? No? Okay. Then I will bring it back to the Planning Commission to for discussion or deliberation. Anybody want to start?
I'll start.
All right, Vice Chair.
Thank you. You know, we've got a half-built house there, I guess, today, or a building that's been stripped down. I think, you know, I do, when I first saw that outdoor room, it did bring up a little bit of a concern for me. But I assume when you spoke about using those to offset RENA numbers, you're talking granny units, and that's something that I think is actually a very valuable thing to have. So I support this project, and don't have any other comments than that.
All right. About Commissioner McCann.
I think the project is very well designed. I appreciate that there are no variances or fudging on any of the, you know, encroachments or anything like that. So I think it's very well designed, and we'll be supportive of it.
Commissioner Claus?
I'm still not crazy about these structures, only because over time, what we're doing is fine and will be just fine, but we don't know what's going to happen 10 years from now or 15, or it could be 60 years from now. However, that being said, I'm certainly not going to be the one person who sort of denies this. It's just, I think it's something that we should continue to look at, because I think we're going to start seeing more and more of these.
Commissioner Murphy.
In relooking at the findings, I think they're all very, very clear to me. And I can't see where there's any deviations with my limited knowledge, and so I would support the project.
All right, thank you. And I agree with my fellow commissioners. You know, it's within the height and the setbacks, and there aren't any variances. And it's always nice to see homes that come before the Planning Commission that people aren't trying to, you know, stretch the envelope and go build the biggest box that they can. So I would be in favor of the project as well. So having us all weighing in on it, do we have a motion? Or can someone propose a motion?
I move to approve the coastal development permit CDP 15-004 to allow for the expansion of the dwelling or the reconstruction of the dwelling at this residence as designed.
And for the record, could you say what address it is?
Sure, it's at 195 Monarch Bay.
All right, so we have a motion by Commissioner McCann. Is there a second?
Chairwoman O'Connor?
Yes.
And I would second that motion.
All right, we have the second by the Vice Chair. Please register your votes. And that motion passes 5-0. Congratulations.
Thank you.
All right, so we move on to item 3, coastal development permit. CDP 14-0019 and minor site development SDP 14-0029M to allow the demolition of an existing single-family dwelling and the construction of a new single-family dwelling within the residential single-family 4 RSF4 zoning district on a coastal bluff at 37 Monarch Bay Drive. Is there a staff report on item 3?
Yeah, there is indeed.
You're up again.
your presentation should be coming up, and there she is. So if I can direct your attention to that presentation. The project is a CDP and minor site development permit to allow the demolition, as you said, of a single-family dwelling and construction of a new one in its place. This property is also located in the Monarch Bay Homeowners Association, although a different location, this one overlooking the ocean on a so-called coastal bluff. The property contains a single-family dwelling, of course, and which would again be demolished under the proposed scope of work. The new building, the new single-family dwelling, would comprise roughly 6,200 square feet and also include a roughly 2,900 square foot basement. The building would be single-story, and so, of course, visible only as a single story from all sides, but again, would have a basement. The way we measure the building's height, that said, is a little unique. Our zoning code says that for structures that propose a basement, you take your starting point for measurement of height from what's seen to be the ideal, I suppose, as the no more than 10-foot tall ceiling. So the ceiling of a 10-foot, maximum 10-foot high basement. In this case, the basement has a taller ceiling than that, and so we go from finished floor, the bottom of the basement, up 10 feet, and again, that's your starting point, and then up to the highest point on the roof. So the overall maximum height of the building per zoning code requirements is 22 feet 6 inches tall. But visibly, one story and no more than 15 feet if you measure the building from dirt to the highest point on the roof. The structure would have four bedrooms. A parking for two vehicles, of course. There is a single retaining wall. I'll explain more of this image in a second, but a single stretch of retaining wall here along the side property, which would vary in height, but at its highest point would be 8 feet tall. CMU covered in stucco and, of course, painted to match the rest of the dwelling. As I mentioned, the property contains a coastal bluff. That's what all of this pertains to. A coastal bluff, you could think of essentially as just a cliff. Goes from flats, drops down to the ocean below. It's considered sensitive habitat area per our general plan. There are setbacks required from coastal bluffs. They're different depending on what part of Dana Point you're in, but there's a default setback for this property, this community, of 40 feet. That said, our zoning code allows a reduction in that setback to as little as 25 feet. But that said, when analysis of the property is done, as is required, of course, looking at potential or projected future erosion of the property, where the factor of safety line is for the property, where the point of stability is located, putting that into an equation, you come up with a total setback from a recommended setback from the edge of bluff. In this case, the recommended setback is 28 feet. So you can go to as little as 25, but when you look at the unique qualities of the property, how it erodes over time, how stable it is, you can come up with a deeper setback than that minimum 25, and in this case, it's 28. The project, of course, meets that standard. In fact, the bulk of the house is set back a few feet further than 28 feet. So again, complies with the requirement. Otherwise, the building meets all other design requirements, setbacks, lot coverage, landscaping, and so forth. More detail about the bluff. In addition to those setbacks, there are very specific landscaping requirements and irrigation requirements, all of with a nod to maintaining the stability of the bluff, making sure that water is going in the correct direction, which is away from the bluff toward the street, and so not leading perhaps to failures, as we've seen on an occasion. So to that end, landscaping that's required is all native to California, drought tolerant. No irrigation is allowed within that area of the setback from the edge of bluff, be it 25, 28, or 50 feet. No irrigation within that area. And no more than 50% of the area can be hardscape, concrete, stone, etc. And the idea there is to allow infiltration as much as possible, and again, general flow of water away from the edge of the bluff, and to make sure it all doesn't come crashing down. In that regard, the building meets those requirements as well. So all water flows in the right direction. All plantings that are proposed under this landscaping plan are drought-tolerant, native to California, et cetera. The project has been, of course, reviewed and approved by the Homeowners Association. There are no variances requested with this project either. Everything meets basic or, by the book, you could say, zoning code requirements. No correspondence has been received for the project. And so, again, as the findings can be made to recommend approval, staff does just that, recommends for approval of the project as proposed. Thank you.
Thank you. Do the commissioners have any questions for staff?
Chair.
Vice Chair?
quick question for you on the setback. Is it building? Are you, is that a building setback? Is it any structure?
Setback from the edge of bluff?
The 28 feet that you showed,
yeah. It's a structure setback, yes.
Okay.
So.
And then on the landscaping, how do you get that plant material to take if you can't irrigate it? Is it hand watered?
Good question. It would have to be hand watered.
Okay.
Yes.
I might have a few more questions. I have some notes here, but for now, that should do it. Thank
okay.
you.
Any other questions? Commissioner
yeah.
Claus?
One question. You have this basement here, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And then, okay, pursuant to this measure, put in the baseline height. How tall is the basement?
Basement. And actually, I should say, forgive me, I would typically have sections and floor plans, but they were created such a large size when I tried to scan them and put them into the PowerPoint, it was absolutely unreadable. So I apologize, otherwise I'd walk
oh,
you through
wait a minute,
the plan.
It's up here.
14 feet.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. And the roof line is?
The roof line would be 15 feet from grade. So if you measure from the dirt to the highest point on the building, it would be no more than 15
feet
tall.
It's not a big difference between the basement and the...
Well, the total height, again, is just under 23 feet. So if you went from finished floor to the top of the roof, it'd be 23.
Oh, okay. All right. You get all the ways to maneuver things.
I guess we have different.
Thank you.
Any questions? Commissioner McCann?
I apologize in advance. I have a bunch of questions. back to Vice Chair's question regarding the setback. And you responded, it's a structure setback. Does that mean, because the canopy encroaches into that setback. Mm-hmm. Canopy is part of structure, but it's not, you know, in the footprint, so, or under the, you know, foundation. So does it or does it not encroach into the setback?
It does encroach into the setback slightly and in certain places, but there's an allowance for that. So the setback from the edge of bluff is just like any other setback, the setback in your side yard, your front yard. And our code allows encroachments into those yards, and depending on what it is you're proposing to build. For roof overhangs, patio extensions, all manner of things, again, there's a certain distance that's allowed. In the case of a roof overhang like this, a patio extension, it's 2 feet 6 inches into the setback.
Okay, so as an architectural projection, it complies with 2 foot 6.
Correct. Now, you wouldn't be able to put posts down into the ground because, again, that's as far as a building footprint can go. But you can extend, you can cantilever certain things out into that yard.
Okay, thank you. You mentioned that the drainage needs to drain away from the bluff and towards the street.
Mm-hmm.
How is that accomplished? I'm kind of guessing that the lot slopes towards the bluff.
No, it actually slopes in the other direction. It's just gravity that's going to be used. So there are drain inlets here and there in the yard, and water catches it, and it just flows via gravity toward the street.
Okay.
So there's no sump pump proposed with this project. It's not being artificially pumped toward the street. It's just flowing via gravity.
Okay. You mentioned in your presentation that, and kind of obviously based on no irrigation allowed and so forth, that we want to keep water away from the coastal bluffs. Mm-hmm. And yet we require, it sounded like possibly 50% of the lot be maintained as non-hardscape
mm-hmm.
to not create an excessive amount of runoff, I guess,
mm-hmm.
which would imply that you want that water to infiltrate,
mm-hmm.
which potentially weakens the bluff. So it seems like they're at odds with each other, those two requirements.
Well, the general idea from our general plan is that the bluff, again, is sensitive habitat area. And so the goal is to have it be as undisturbed as possible, ideally. And that, of course, would include native landscaping. That's part of the natural form, the original form of the bluff. So that's the encouragement, is to just see native plantings. There are things that, yeah, would allow infiltration, but as part of the way the bluff always was, or before people got here. That said, we do allow hardscape, again, up to half of the area of the setback can be turned into concrete for use by the property owner. So I'm dancing your question a little bit, but some infiltration is accepted and allowed and appropriate because that's the way the bluff has always been. But we don't want to see overwatering of the bluff, something that would oversaturate it and eventually lead to collapse, perhaps, of the area. Nor do we want to just see a completely wall-to-wall as hardscape because that wouldn't be wouldn't indicate the natural form of the bluff. That isn't the way it always was.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. The 8 foot, you mentioned 8 foot fences, and I read in the staff report about 8 foot fences. You said retaining walls, but I just want to clarify, the retaining wall is only 3 feet, correct? And then it's got just a privacy fence on top? Okay. And is that fence hidden? It looked from the pictures that there were very large hedges on both sides. Is that fence going to be visible from the neighboring properties? Or kind of it's on this property's side and it's hidden on the other side by hedges? But it's only 5 feet visible from the from the neighboring side, correct?
Forgive me, I may need to double check on that, see if I can get some elevations from the topo survey and then compare to the top of the wall.
Well, that's okay. I mean, my impression, I don't mean to put you on the spot, my impression was that it would only be 5 foot visible from the neighboring side, which seems very reasonable to me.
Mm-hmm.
Is the fact that it's an 8 foot fence, is that any kind of above max variance, or no, that's within allowed?
No, that is, well, it's allowed subject to approval of a minor site development permit. So our code would say that in that part of your property for any retaining wall of any form or any combination, be it fence and wall, or just a solid wall, you would need, or I'm sorry, the maximum height that would be permitted is 6 feet. So the fence plus
unless
wall combination,
prove
unless you approve more via a site development permit.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. There's going to be a lot of excavation for the basement. It's a large basement. Are there any special excavation requirements or shoring requirements, or does that just all get taken care of at the time of permitting with the building department?
The project will need a grading permit, in addition to building permits, of course. And so, yes, it'll be worked out as part of the plan check process, as part of the issuance of all of those permits. If your question is an allusion to the bluff, is there any requirements there, all of the work that's proposed for the basement would be outside of the setback area, and so it just falls under the standards of any other home that proposes a basement.
Is there any concern about truck traffic or hours relating to all that export?
There, we also need I think it's called a transportation permit. So vehicles going in and out of the neighborhood hauling debris of one sort or another would need to be approved for that permit, and they would follow a schedule for in and out. Generally, construction has limitations on hours, and there are conditions of approval to that effect. So between about 7 in the morning and 8 o'clock in the evening, Monday through Saturday, if memory serves. So there are general requirements for construction, and then the trucks in general, if they are proposing to transport large amounts of dirt and debris in and out of neighborhoods, they would need a special kind of permit, again, a transportation permit, to haul things in and out.
Who issues that permit? Is it the traffic subcommittee or the building department? Or
building department.
Okay.
And I might add that I think the neighborhood, HOA, they have their own more specific and more restrictive requirements than the city does. So.
Okay. And then lastly, the recording studio, I know it's in the basement. Is that envisioned to be a personal use studio or some kind of a professional?
No, I've spoken to the property owner about that. It's just for personal use.
Okay. Okay, and it looked per the plans that there was noise attenuation planned in the ceiling of that and so forth, so. Thank you.
And that was my concern also. I mean, I noticed that there was an acoustical treatment cavity, but that sounded more geared towards, you know, sound recording more than it did to noise abatement. I mean, is there anything that's planned to for noise abatement?
Again, I don't have structural plans just yet, but I do know the basement, of course, will be under a slab and under wholly underground, surrounded by dirt. So with a floor above that, so you have to be quite loud to get sound to escape from the basement.
I've got teenagers or college-age kids in the basement, then they can make a lot of noise.
If you look on page A21 of the plans, there is a section of the basement, and that I noticed that there's actually an acoustical cavity separating the ceiling of the recording studio from the floor above. And that typically those cavities, if they're air sealed off, then sound is really attenuated very well.
Okay, hopefully that's true. As I said, when the kids start putting on the surround sound, and it sounds like their helicopters landing in my basement, but any other questions for staff? Commissioner Murphy?
Just a clarification. When you were speaking about the overhang from the house, and if El Nino does come and we get a lot of rain, and I think there was discussion that overhang is a little bit past the designated setback line. I don't know. I've not been up on those bluffs to know, is there fencing beyond? I mean, as you look out from the home, you can have fencing by the home's exterior. But is there further fencing at the end of the bluff, or is that there's nothing to stop that erosion?
Correct. Yeah, in some cases we've allowed low-level fencing or walls, I should say. Pardon me, walls no taller than 18 inches within the setback from edge of bluff. But the general idea is that nothing is out there other than hardscape and native planting. So no, to answer your question, there wouldn't be any fencing or walls or other barriers.
So in the event that we do get a lot of rain, can I feel secure that these plans will address that as well?
Well, the home has to meet all California building code requirements, which speak to things like wind shear and ceiling and so forth. Building permits can't be issued until we find that it complies with all of those standards. But above and beyond that, an architect could speak a little bit like of it. I mean, other than say, it will have to meet all current building codes, which do speak to all manner of things, including weather, of course. So,
well, a good majority of the drainage is collected. That comes off the roof and off the surface, hard surface areas, is collected and drains back towards the street away from the bluff. So that improves that erosion situation quite a bit. The bluffs do naturally erode. And in fact, as part of the geotechnical analysis that has to be done to determine what the required setback is, one of the calculations is an estimate by the geologists of 50 years of erosion. And so that's actually factored into the setback.
Yes, I did read that. 50 years into the future was the issue, which is pretty impressive. I don't think we'll be around to see if it worked. But no, some of us might. Okay, I think that... I was looking at the minor site development permit. I think that was answered. Yeah, that's answered. Thank you.
Vice Chair, did you have any further questions? Or that was it? Okay.
Critical.
Commissioner Claus.
Is the architect here?
Yes.
Would he like to come to the podium and give us his name and city of residence?
All right, I'd like to open the public hearing. Welcome to the Planning Commission. After your, please state your name and city of residence, and then when you're done, fill out a speaker slip form for the record.
Okay. My name is Frank Stultz. I'm with South Coast Architects.
Okay. What I'm interested in is what made you use this particular architecture on this particular structure?
It is a kind of an eclectic approach to contemporary architecture, with materials that we consider more old world materials.
Could you speak a little louder, sure, please, into the microphone?
Yeah, what I was trying to say is that it is a eclectic approach to a contemporary with forms and materials that represent more old world materials. with the continuation of clients looking for contemporary, more livable interior spaces, these forms complement that approach. Obviously, there are restrictions to the heights in this community, and so because of that, we are trying to also complement that aesthetically in the best way we can.
Okay. Have you done anything else in this particular neighborhood?
No, not in this neighborhood.
Unique neighborhood. Okay.
Not in this neighborhood.
All right. Thank you.
Okay.
I have a question for you before you leave. Is there any noise mitigation on the recording studio basement
what
that acoustical treatment center or cavity?
It was a great question. What Evan said, and excuse me, what John had mentioned also, this client loves music. He does his own private library recordings, and so he has collectively invested into this structure below grade, probably about $1 million in acoustics, and is there completely to soundproof his space so he gets the best sound evaluation of what he's trying to do with his recordings. So, you know, I didn't mean to chuckle, but he is doing everything he will to make sure that no one hears him or he hears anything from the outside. So it is a very detailed process to make sure that happens.
Okay. Any other questions for the architect? Well, thank you very much.
Thanks.
Are there any other requests to speak forms? No? All right. So then I will close the public hearing and bring it back to the commissioners for deliberation. Anybody would like to start us off? Commissioner Claus.
Well, as you know, I love this neighborhood, and I love what has been done to it over the years. It's really a somewhat older neighborhood, and various combination of the owners and the architects are able to continue to revive it and make it new and different. And I think that this is very well done, and I think the biggest issue that I hear from my fellow commissioners is the noise issue. That was one of the reasons I brought up the architect, and I think that, for me at least, he made it very, very clear that that's not going to be a problem. And if it is a problem, then obviously we'll come back and chit-chat. So I'm very supportive of this.
Thank you, Commissioner Claus. Commissioner McCann.
I'm supportive of this project. I think they've done a beautiful job. It's obvious they've investing a ton of money into make this beautiful in every way. I'm only tempted to add a condition of approval that planning commissioners get to go see it near its completion.
We want to be in the basement with the music.
All right, thank you, Vice Chair.
Sure. I think it's great. I've got a little bit of experience dealing with an acoustical issue, and what I know is it's really what I was told, not what I know. I apologize. Is that it's the low frequency sound waves become more problematic at higher volume, and with it being down below grade, I think that likely solved that issue. Architecturally, it's very well done, and while I'd like to second that motion that we have to visit.
Commissioner Murphy.
I also support the project. It occurs to me as I read and have studied this, it's consistent. The project's consistent with the Dana Point zoning code and the local coastal program and the CDP, all the things that we want to look at specifically up there on our very special bluffs as we're, you know, going through this. And and looking at the findings, there is a big emphasis, which there has to be, on preserving Dana Point's bluff as a natural and scenic resource. And we're always, I think, happy to have homes built with that in mind, with people that really are sincere about that. So I'm all for it.
All right. I agree with my fellow commissioners, with regard to, I'm a former 13-year resident of Monarch Bay, so I'm very familiar with the HOA's very strict construction hours, and I was actually a part of that because we didn't like hearing construction on the weekends. There were some projects there, that two homes in particular, that took over 5 years to build, and it became a nuisance to the neighborhood. So they really became very strict in limiting hours and the types of trucks that could come through. And it's actually, you know, quite expensive. They charge by, you know, how many axles the truck has, you know, to because they have to pay for, you know, hauling out dirt from the basements of these, you know, mega mansions. So I'm not concerned about that part. I think Monarch Bay has done a great job with that. Blufftop living is always very risky. You know, one of the homes along there, the landscaper left the hose on and, you know, the slope slid. So we may have these wonderful 50-year plans of erosion, but then you get, you know, somebody that makes a mistake and there goes the bluff. But hopefully, you know, with the drought-tolerant plants and everything, and now that we're getting some irrigation off the bluff, that will help mitigate some of those issues. But obviously, it's a beautiful home, and there's no better location, I think, in Dana Point, really. So with that, anybody want to propose a motion?
I would make a motion.
Okay.
That's okay with you. Okay.
Please.
I move Coastal Development Permit CDP 14-0019 and Minor Site Development Minor Site Development SDP 14-00029M to allow the demolition of an existing single-family dwelling and the construction of a new single-family dwelling within the residential single-family Y4RS zoning district, Coastal Bluff, at 37. Is it just 37 Monarch Bay Drive? Mm-hmm. Okay. And I so move.
All right. So Commissioner Claus has made the motion. Is there a second? All right, Commissioner Murphy has seconded. Please register your votes. And that motion passes 5-0. Congratulations. All right, now we have item 4, Coastal Development Permit CDP 12-0006 and Site Development Permit SDP 12-0007. To allow the demolition of an existing single-family dwelling and the construction of a new single-family dwelling on land located within the residential Beach Road 12, RBR 12, zoning district, as well as the city's floodplain overlay district at 35537 Beach Road. Is there a staff report on item 4?
And there is. And the presentation, of course, is on your screen. As you mentioned, the subject property is located along Beach Road in the Capistrano Beach community. The trigger here for the coastal development permit and site development permit is, as with the other projects, on the demolition of an existing dwelling and the construction of a new one on land located within the city's coastal overlay district, also known as the coastal zone, and also a development proposed within the city's floodplain overlay district as the trigger for a site development permit. The subject property contains, of course, a single-family dwelling, originally built in 1948. It's two stories. You can see some photographs inside and out. That building would, of course, be demolished in favor of the proposed scope of work, which is a new single-family dwelling. That structure would be roughly 2,500 square feet and also have an attached roughly 500 square foot garage with parking for two vehicles. There are three bedrooms proposed within the floor plan. Two stories, but three levels, on the mid-level being a mezzanine, but officially two stories. You can see the facade here, a very modern design, concrete by and large as the exterior material, and punctuated by large amounts of glass, as you can see specifically at the rear of the building. The property, as I mentioned, is in the floodplain overlay district, and so that designation denotes that the property is subject to larger than average waves, just inundated in general by more waves than you find in other places along the coast. And because of that fact, buildings are required to meet very specific design requirements, and with a nod toward protecting specifically the habitable parts of the structure. Specifically, buildings must be founded on caissons rooted deep into the earth, and then the whole of the building, save for the garage, elevated to a height above mean sea level, and as recommended by a qualified expert through something called a wave run-up report. There are datum points, there are fixed points that the federal government has come up with and used for many, many years, and which are used as, again, the starting point and to figure out what roughly the average height of ocean water is. And so from that point, then, the expert recommends a height above that mean sea level to elevate the whole of the structure. In addition to that, the wave run-up report will look at what the average height of a breaking wave is in this particular part of Dana Point, and then again try to come up with an overall height to elevate the building, and so that water will not crash directly into the habitable parts of the home, but rather flow underneath it, and then on and through to Beach Road. The exception to that, as I mentioned a moment ago, is the garage. Garages can be located right at the level of the street, and simply because, you want direct access from the road, not have to drive down or up in some kooky way. But otherwise, all habitable parts of the building, again, are elevated. From there, with that information, and there it is, starting point is called a base flood elevation. That recommended height above mean sea level is called a base flood elevation, or BFE. From that point, to measure building height, we go then another 18 inches above, and that becomes your starting point for measuring building height. So in this case, the building has a sloped roof or a barreled roof design, which would qualify for the steepest pitch, and so the tallest possible building in this zoning district, which would be 28 feet. So again, you have your BFE, you go 18 inches above that, and then from there up 28 feet. Continuing on that theme or discussion of how to protect the home from the ocean, water, as I mentioned, of course, is intended to flow under the building and then crash through the garage and onto the street. There are a number of ways that can be accomplished. Breakaway panels are the most common one. In fact, let me go back a step. You can see a differential, of course, a difference between the finished floor of the living room here and then the floor of the garage. Most typically, there would be a breakaway panel here, which could be a grate or just a thin piece of something or other. Water would flow under the house, crash into it, and it does just as the title says, breaks away and allows the water to continue to flow through the garage and then onto Beach Road, and again, protecting the house above. In this case, a more unique design was envisioned. Water continues to flow underneath, scour away the sand, flow underneath. But when it gets to this wall, this end wall as it's called, water crashes, goes straight up, breaks out a grate that sits just in front of the garage, and water again flows onto the street, and the house above is protected. The home, in general, just as with the others, has no variances requested. It meets its setback requirements, its minimum parking requirements, landscaping, the overall height as I discussed. No exceptions or deviations are proposed, and so, of course, the findings can be made to recommend approval of the CDP. There's been no correspondence from the public. There is no HOA on Beach Road. It's a formally district, or legally speaking, a district, and so no formal approval is given to the city from that body, but the project is approved. And so, again, as the findings can be made, staff recommends the project be approved as proposed. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions for staff?
I do.
Commissioner Murphy.
If you could explain what a caisson is. I'm not familiar with these terms,
sure.
Except for the caissons come running. But anyway, and I was looking at the picture, what is the caisson? Is it the foot?
It's essentially, I'm not an engineer, so I'm going to kind of muddle through it with you, I suppose, but essentially it's a large cylindrical pile or pole, you can think of it. A very, very thick pole that it comprises a part of the foundation of the building. There are a series of them scattered all throughout the foundation of the building. Again, they're driven deep into the earth and to provide extraordinary support for the building, to keep the building in place and founded in the event of erosion over time, because, of course, sand comes in and out with the tides. And as I mentioned, water can crash into the building in an extraordinary event, and so possibly wash things away, break things up. So the caissons ground the building in place. Think of like lots of very thick legs holding the building exactly where it's supposed to be.
Okay. I don't know if you were ever familiar, but it just made me think about it. Up in Solano Beach, outside of Ventura,
mm-hmm.
there were homes that they built right on the, the sand.
Mm-hmm.
Where they, instead of a caisson being built up on caissons, they just open their front doors and open their back doors, and they just all the on the high seas would just roll through.
Well, in fact, you can see in the existing home, if I'll go back to that first photograph, that's exactly how this current building, 1948-era building, was constructed, just a slab-on-grade, as it's called. Just the foundation of the building dropped right onto the earth. So you can see there's very little differential between the sand at the foreground of this picture and your living room. So
in fact, in some storms, the water has been known to go into the homes.
Yeah.
And that's why the new requirements require you to be built higher and actually on these piles that support the building. It's interesting, there's actually no earth really there. There's no dirt. It's all sand. And in many cases, it's 40, 30, 40, 50, 60 feet deep until you actually hit rock. And so these caissons go all the way down to the rock. So theoretically, all that sand and everything could wash away and the building would still stand on stilts.
I should point out an additional aspect, and aside from safety that I've mentioned over and over, again, sand erosion in and out with the tides, that's the normal part of the replenishment of our coastline. If a building was, or in the original ways of doing things, with the building just sitting on the ground, to protect the building in the event of water washing up, seawalls were created. So people would oftentimes put large barriers between the house and the water itself. That construction would stop that natural in and out of sand. And so over time, sand is lost. It's damaging the environment in a way. So another benefit of modern construction of these caissons is it allows the in and out of sand, the natural processes of the coastline to occur. It doesn't interrupt that process. So there's many, many benefits, not just safety related.
What are the, I mean, I've walked on the beach, down Beach Road, and seen the fronts of all these homes, and there certainly is a large range of ages of the homes and sizes of the homes. I'm curious to know, is this because it's considered a district? I mean, are they self-governing? Is that like a self-governing district rather than an HOA? Does that affect what the city does in terms of the abilities to regulate this?
Jennifer might be able to answer this better than we, but they're still governed by city's ordinances. They do, I think, in terms of improving all their own streets and some of their storm drainage, as well as possibly even their sewer. I think that's all managed by their own district. So there's clearly a difference between a HOA and a district, but beyond that, that's about my extended knowledge. I think Jennifer could probably expound upon that more.
Yeah, because there's districts throughout Orange County. I think there's like 30 or something separate districts, and I would I'm just assuming maybe they sort of participate in the same level of that kind of.
Yeah, they actually call themselves the Community Services District, so that's their title.
Okay.
But strangely, they have no HOA. They've no CC&Rs.
Right. Okay, that's all I have. Thank you.
Yes. Vice Chair.
Thank you, Chairwoman O'Connor. A couple questions for you, Evan. On the building setbacks, I'm looking at the string line here. Is the patio or the deck area above, is that a projection? And that is that allowed to project past the string line?
Correct. And that, with every other aspect of the home, has very specific design requirements to meet. There's a maximum projection oceanward the deck can extend. There's also a maximum percentage of the whole of the facade that the balcony can cover. There is a minimum distance from the side property lines at 6 feet on either side. So, yes, it has a maximum projection, and all dimensions have to meet certain numerical requirements.
Great, thank you. And then these are caissons, right, not piles? They're not pile driving?
The term is interchangeable, actually. Mm-hmm.
Okay. They're both one of them.
These are poured.
They're poured, so they're going to
Yeah, they actually have to put a sleeve down through the sand in order to pump it out.
Okay. let's see. And then the other question I had is in relation to the skylights. Can you walk me through? I couldn't find a detail in the plans. It looks like the skylights are above the overall height. Is that another projection? And can you I was trying to figure out the math on a
It's a good question, actually.
Yeah, based on a percentage, if you don't have really any flat horizontal.
It's a great question. It was, I want to say an interpretation, but it was a determination that had to be made because our code doesn't speak to barrel roof designs. It envisions just a traditional gable, the steepness, pitch. So in this case, this was actually done back in 2008 with a different iteration of this house, but essentially you just find the apex. You found the midpoint there and just were able to calculate out the percentages of rise and run, if memory serves, and
so
it was determined.
The formula that went into the
yes.
approval here. And, okay.
Yes. Oh, and I'm sorry, but you mentioned about the skylights. Yes, just as with balconies and others, it's listed as an architectural projection and has a maximum height. It can go above the maximum height for the zoning district.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Any other questions? Commissioner McCann?
Back to just a little slightly bit more detail on some of the vice chair's questions. So the caissons are going down to bedrock. Okay, and I assume there was geological report done with this. Do they know,
certainly.
I'm just curious, and if you don't know, that's fine, but what is the depth of bedrock here?
Mm-hmm.
Or just approximately, because I heard a number up to 50, 60 feet thrown out. Was it that severe? Yeah.
So 17 plus 20.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. On the plans, it says building string line. Does that mean building setback line?
Essentially, and forgive me, I did a poor job of explaining that. There are two setbacks from rear property lines, and they're unique to Beach Road, as opposed to more inland properties. Because the rear property line is difficult to find, of course, being right
sure.
up against the ocean there, instead of finding that point, rather, the rear property line and going forward some distance, whatever it happens to be, the setback, per se, is actually a maximum distance as measured from the front property line.
Right.
So you go a certain distance, and it's unique for each side, by the way, of the property. It's not a fixed 50 feet back or 100 feet back. It could be 113 feet oceanward from the front property line on the east side, and it could be 98 feet on the other. And the reason for that staggered distance, is that it follows the contours of the coastline, and with a nod, I presume, toward protecting people's views, making sure that all homes aren't out at uniform distance, and so creating, for some people, a blockage up and down the coast. So the rear setback, the string lines, are unique for each property as you go up and down Beach Road. But that's how it's measured. It's from the front property line oceanward, not from the rear property line inward.
Okay, thank you for that more detailed explanation. So is this property, because it talks about it being at the T turnaround on Beach Road, so its front PL is further back than the others.
Correct.
Okay, but the string lines take that into account.
They do.
Okay.
Yeah.
So is 2.5 feet the max architectural projection overhang for this Beach Road area? Because I don't have a dimension here. I'm looking at sheet A4.1.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, kind of graphically, it seems like it's more than 2.5 feet, but there's no dimension to say that.
Architectural projections differ depending on what the projection is. So balconies, for example, have a different projection in depending on what yard you're in, as opposed to a skylight or as opposed to a deck on posts. Everything, again, has a unique standard. So for a balcony, and specifically between the structure and the patio string line, I believe it's 6 feet of projection. I think I need to double check the zoning
code.
Okay,
so it's been checked. It's more than 2.5 feet.
Yes, it is.
Okay, because yeah, I'm sitting here looking at it graphically and thinking that's a lot more than 2.5.
No, it certainly is greater than 2.5 feet. Yes, I memory serves.
But it's within. You checked it. It's within the.
Yes.
The envelope.
As I said, yeah, balconies have a certain width, depth, a maximum percentage of the width of the face of the building. Every side has a standard it has to meet, and it complies with all of those.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Commissioner Claus, any questions?
Yeah, I have always been under the impression that the Beach Road properties were actually never really meant to be regular homes. They were beach homes. Originally,
30s,
right? 40s. Okay, yeah. And so, and also they're directly across the street from something that has had a number of problems coming of this hillside falling down. And I think there's one in particular that I remember got all the way across and did some, I think, fairly significant damage. Am I correct on that?
In the early 1990s, if memory serves.
In the yeah. Oh, that's nice. Right. So that would be one of my concerns, is what's across the street from you.
Well, the homes of Beach Road are separated, of course, by Pacific Coast Highway, and then a set of train tracks, and then there's a sound wall, and then in most cases there's even a row of parking beyond that. So there's a good hundreds of feet between the edge of the bluff that you're referring to on the other side of Pacific Coast Highway and the nearest home. So it would have to be quite the traumatic event, quite the failure to get all the way to a home. But I suppose it's possible.
I was told by a staff member at one time that basically there's a slide every single month. And sometimes more, 5 to 6. They're just small. But once we get the great earthquake, then, yeah, Beach Road is one of the first to go. Okay.
I have some questions. Now, if a wave takes out these homes on Beach Road, is it the Coastal Commission that says they can't rebuild?
No. Certainly, if there's an event that destroys your home that's out of your control, it wasn't done intentionally, then our code states that you can replace a legally established use of a building or what have you that was built with permits just as it was before. And again, assuming the event that destroyed it was out of your control, you didn't light your own house on fire or what have you. So yes, these homes would be able to be reconstructed just as they were before, and again, assuming they were built in the first place with a permit of some kind.
All right, and then the corrugated metal roof, I'm assuming that's, you know, non-glare and...
I'd defer to the architect on that, but I would assume so. Yeah, it would be.
Yeah, because the people up on Camino Capistrano are probably going to be blinded. But, yeah, we'll have the architect talk about that. Any other questions for staff? All right. Commissioner McCann.
Sorry, I do have another question. Back again to Vice Chair's question with regards to, and maybe we just discussed this at some other point, but sounds like you guys, did they get a height bump for 6 and 12 based on the barrel roof?
Not a bump. Our code gives you a maximum height for a building, and depending on what kind of roof that you utilize, what the pitch of the roof is specifically. So in this case, again, a determination was made that a barrel roof would qualify as the steepest pitch or the equivalent to the steepest pitch allowed, and so they were permitted to go right up to 28 feet, which, again, is the maximum height for the zoning district.
Right, and I don't want to make it an issue. I think it's a separate discussion we should have later, but you could also make an argument that most of the roof is flatter than 6 and 12, and therefore, you know, should not get that extra max height. So that's it for my question.
All right. I'll open up the public hearing if the architect wants to come up and address some of these questions. Please state your name and city of residence.
Good evening, Mark Singer, architect for the project.
Can you possibly explain if there's a glare on the corrugated roof or?
When it's first installed, but within a, it's a standing seam roof. Within probably a month or two, it sort of gathers a patina because it's brushed. And after that, it's almost like the turn metal that you see in London and a lot of places in Europe.
All right. Any other questions for the architect? I think there was somebody else had a question. I don't remember.
On the question of the roof slope, where sections of it might be flatter, there's also sections that are much steeper. So I think on average, what we did was we took point A and point B, connected it with a straight line. So the loci of points meets the average.
Okay.
Makes sense.
Thank you. Okay. Any other requests to speak forms? No? All right. I'll close the public hearing, bring it back to the planning commissioners for deliberation. Anyone want to start? Vice Chair, you hit
sure.
the button like
I
you're
did
ready.
I did hit the button. Thank you, Chairwoman O'Connor. I, you know, coastal living is not for the faint of heart. Just to build here seems like a tremendous task. So it's a nice design. I fully support the project and appreciate the depth that you went into in your staff report as well.
And Commissioner Murphy.
I agree, and I, just as a side note, I'm familiar with Mark Singer's work in Laguna Beach decades ago. So it brings great color to what we have here. Wonderful, wonderful work. Everything that I've looked at seems fine. I looked at the project compliance with the floodplan regulations because, of course, that was not in our other subjects tonight, and that was something that, you know, was stood out to me, but I fully support it.
And Commissioner McCann.
I did some back of the envelope calculation, looking at the ridge elevation and the eave elevation and dividing it out, it's less than 6 and 12. I don't want to make a point of that, but I do think it's warrants discussion or further study at some point. That being said, I think it's a great design. I think it's a very challenged lot and very narrow. And I think they did a really, really good job designing, getting that mezzanine in there, creating a little bit of extra living space. I think it'll be a beautiful amenity to the city, and I'm supportive of the project.
Commissioner Claus?
I think this has been very well vetted, and I think even though we spoke to the architect slightly, I'm also familiar with his work, and I believe he's been here before, and his work is good, and you know he knows there. And I also think that the staff has put this together based on the reality of living there and made it, I mean, definitely made it better. So, I'm clearly in support of this.
Thank you. I'm not a big fan of corrugated roofing material, but it's not enough for me to, turn down the project. I agree with Vice Chair Nelson that it's not for the faint of heart living on Beach Road. I could never close my eyes and sleep at night thinking that big wave's going to come. But it's a beautiful location, and I think you've done a nice job with designing it. And if we have a motion, it sounds like we're all in agreement.
Chairwoman O'Connor, I make a motion that we approve Coastal Development Permit CDP 12-006 and Site Development Permit SDP 12-007 to allow for the demolition of an existing single-family dwelling and the construction of a new single-family dwelling on land located within the residential Beach Road 12, RBR-12 zoning district as well as the city's floodplain overlay district at 35537 Beach Road.
The motion was made by Vice Chair Nelson. Is there a second?
Second.
And that second was made by Commissioner McCann. Please register your votes. And we have 5-0 in favor. So congratulations. Good luck. Now we go to old business. There is no old business. New business? There is no new business. How about staff reports? Looks like we have a presentation by our director.
Yes, and I apologize that, oh, it looks like it is appearing on your screens.
Yeah.
I was told it wasn't going to, so I don't know if it will the whole time. You might have to turn around and look at the big screen if it disappears from your smaller screen. This is a presentation that I've been asked to give, and I've been updating it as we go along, as new projects get entitled. And I thought it would be interesting for the two more tenured commissioners to see some of your hard work here all in one place, and then for some of the newer commissioners to see some of the projects that we refer to from time to time. So this first slide is a construction activity snapshot. This was from September of 2014, and hopefully on your screens you can see it a little bit better, but all of the blue dots represent commercial permits and the yellow dots represent residential permits. And in the month of September, if you would have driven around town, these would have all been active permits. So at that time in September, these were active construction sites. And it represents 53 million of residential construction at that time and 7 million of commercial construction. This next slide is just breaking down the residential component, and there were categories less than $100,000 worth of improvements, and then the red dot represents $1 million or greater. And you can see that over in the Monarch Beach area, there's a few red dots over in the Headlands area and over on Beach Road and in Capistrano, and those are the areas that you would suspect that you would see those red dots. This next slide shows commercial construction, and we are largely a residential community, so it makes sense that we're having a lot more activity on the residential side. Here, the valuations were less. We only had three projects that were greater than $500,000 on the commercial side. One was Shea's project, which is the Ralph Center over on the corner of Del Avion and Golden Lantern. That was the recent renovation that they went through that you might be familiar with. The other is actually the city's project over at Sea Terrace Park. That was the maintenance facility that's been completed. And then the third project at this time that was over this amount was St. Edward's School did a major renovation. Moving on, this is now looking at discretionary approvals. So this is projects that you all should be intimately familiar with, at least Commissioner Claus and Chairwoman O'Connor. So here, the green dots represent approved projects, and the yellow dots were pending. And you can see a lot of activity over in the Headlands area. Whoops, what happened here? Maybe. Able to connect to the network on this? Can Evan connect to the network? Evan, if you pull it open, go to the planning drive. We'll pull it up there. Technology.
Yeah.
Well.
Devious thought.
I think so. It's Oh, great. Thank you, Evan. Okay, so we go back one, I think. Let me see.
Yeah.
Okay, so those were the, okay, we just talked about that. Oh, yes, go on to the next one. So then in 2014, we had $86 million worth of residential and commercial investment here in town, and you can see the progression over the past few years. This is based on building valuation permits, so this is probably actually a little bit low because folks tend to tell us their projects are worth a little bit less because that's how we calculate their building permit fees. Next slide, please. So then in 2014, these were the various projects that were approved over on the left and then pending. Actually, I need to move the Ritz-Carlton over to approved, and then South Shores Church as well. Although, actually, no, that one needs to stay in pending, and I'll explain why when I get to that slide. Anything in the light blue is in the town or the Lantern District area. Next slide, please, Evan. So you're all very familiar with this. Next slide, please. This was the first project that was entitled in the Lantern District. This is on Del Prado, on the corner of Del Prado and Violet Lantern, across the street from Lux. And this was a project, 18 dwelling units over almost 8,000 square feet of commercial space. It currently has a green fence around it. They did do some preliminary grading. Unfortunately, the applicant... there were some changes in the real estate market, and he realized that his revenue assumptions were too high, and he didn't quite factor in the cost of some of the improvements, in particular the subterranean parking. So as next slide, please. Here are some elevations of renderings of what this project was supposed to look like. And then here's it in section view, and you can see it has 2.5 levels of the subterranean parking. And unfortunately, the project costs just exceed the revenue, so there's a cost structure problem here. That's another. Okay, so now we're going to talk about the Majestic project. This is sort of across the street. If you look up at the big screen, if my pointer works, this was the parcel we were just looking at. This is Violet. And so the Majestic project encompasses a total of 7 parcels. They were calling this phase one. This is where Bella Bazaar is currently located, and the OC Beads. This was called phase two. You have the Shell gas station. You have the Tie This over here. And then phase three over here, which has some office. I'm kind of drawing a blank right now. What's over there? This project includes a total of 109 residential units over 32,500 square feet of commercial. The developer, I believe, is in contract right now with an entity. So Majestic is out of Texas, and they're really a commercial developer, a retail developer. And so they had an offering out early in 2015, looking for a residential partner. And from what I can gather, most of the entities that are interested in the project don't want a partner. They want to take it on. So I believe they're in contract to within those discussions. Next slide, please. So this is just a site plan. Again, a site plan showing all the public open space, the courtyards that were incorporated as part of the project. So 16% of the total project area is public open court space. Next slide, please. This is phase one in section view. Elevations for phase one. Again, phase one. Section for phase two. Same. And then phase three, which has a slightly different look. As you can recall, phase one and phase two are directly across the street from each other on Amber Lantern, so they face each other. But there was feedback from the commission relative to phase three, really wanting a different sort of architectural feel, and they did that. And here is a rendering. You can see the schwack, the burger in the corner, right-hand corner of your screen, and that is what the project would look like within the context. This is a project that you are all very well familiar with at this point. This is where the BevMo site is anticipated to go, but this was entitled as a, you know, slightly less than 5,000 square foot single-story commercial building, and so there will be a sign program coming before you for BevMo in the not-too-distant future. And here is just a site plan. Here's an elevation of the building. We worked really hard with the applicant, and this is well before we knew who was going to be going in here, that we wanted a Spanish Revival-influenced building, that this part of the couplet and then the other part of the couplet that has the historic former Woodruff sales office building, they're both smaller scale buildings, the Spanish Revival, and we wanted the district to be bookended with both of those types of buildings. And here's a sort of rough rendering that they're working on. This project is now back on the other side of the couplet that I was talking about. This was a former carpet store, and this is going to be a less than 3,000 square foot restaurant. You can now, if you drive by, you'll see it's under construction. It's scheduled to open up in fall. Next slide, please. Here's an elevation. Next slide. And here's a rendering, and you can see that on site as well. This is not too far from that particular property. This is the historic Blue Fountain Cafe. So again, as you're coming into the Lantern District from the north, it's that first building there over off of Del Prado. And this owner is willing to do a historic renovation compliant with the Secretary of Interior standards for renovation. So they are bringing it back to its former historic glory, and they have a restaurant tenant that they have signed a lease agreement with. This is scheduled to open in early 2016, and called Coastal Kitchen, and sort of California cuisine menu. We're getting more information from the tenant to hopefully post to our website soon. We're going to add to our economic development section a coming soon. So as we learn of new retail tenants coming into town, folks can check that out. Here's a couple renderings of what that will look like. This is a project that went before the Planning Commission in a study session. This is located at the corner of Golden Lantern and Pacific Coast Highway. We call it the Union Bank property because Union Bank's the prominent tenant there on the site. This was purchased in foreclosure, so the developer got it for a good land price. And next slide. I'm sorry, I need to update this. This is, do you recall, John, the number of dwelling units that this project had? Oh, sorry, Evan, 39. 39, and how many square feet of commercial? Okay, so this is here a site plan. You can see it in context with some of the adjacent buildings. Next, you can see here this in section, and they're actually doing three levels of subterranean parking here, which is quite ambitious. And again, I think it's their low land cost that is enabling them to be able to do this. The reason this hasn't come before you yet is when the city did its public improvements along Pacific Coast Highway, there were a number of utilities that were found in the area, and they need to be temporarily relocated while they're doing their shoring and for their garage. And they found that to be quite expensive and unanticipated. And so they were trying to do some value engineering and look at some different options in order to reduce that cost. Next slide, please. I've been told recently that they've come up with a solution, so we're expecting them to resubmit, and we'd be able to hopefully deem their application complete soon, and this would become before you in a public hearing. But here are some renderings of the project. This project is the former Dana Marina Inn, AKA, you'll hear us from time to time when we slip calling it the Bates Motel. This currently has a green fence around it, is dilapidated, is a big problem. The reason why it's taking so long is that the Coastal Commission, when they approved the town center plan, they put in a policy that says that any affordable lodging, and they specifically called out this building as affordable lodging, would need to pay an affordable lodging in lieu fee, a per bed count. So there were 24 rooms with one bed per room, so there's 24 beds that a fee needs to be paid for. And unfortunately, the plan didn't specify the number of the fee, so we were left to negotiate with state parks what that fee should be. So we're making progress in those discussions, and once we're able to figure that out and get some agreement, this will be coming before you. probably in two separate CDPs, one just for demolition, and then a separate for the entire project. But get next slide, Evan, please. So here's a site plan of the project. Next slide. This, too, is similar. It's, I think, 30-something dwelling units over about 8,000 square feet of commercial. And here you can see it in section. There's a few other sections that we'll show. And here are some elevations. Next slide. Here is, this is we call the former mobile home park site. This is over on the corner of Pacific Coast Highway and Del Obispo. Next slide, please. Here's, you can see another aerial of the site. Next slide. Here's site plan. This is 168 condos. And with some, this pink area up along PCH represents a linear park. And there's some very minimal commercial that's incorporated into this area over here. This project is been, it was entitled by the entity that came before the Planning Commission, and they sold it to a builder out of San Diego County called Zephyr. And they are, we've been meeting with them. They are very anxious to get going on the project and start grading in October of this year. And moving this along. They're very excited about the project. Next slide, please, Evan. Here's some renderings of the project. They've mentioned that they feel that Dana Point is very similar to Carlsbad 10 years ago, where Carlsbad was sort of this poor stepchild to La Jolla and some other parts of San Diego. And they feel that Dana Point is sort of that way compared to Laguna Beach and Newport Beach. And they see a lot of value here, upside, and they've paid more for this property than they set a new comp in purchasing this property. So hopefully they will be successful, and I think it will be an attractive entry into town. We're excited by the linear park opportunity. Sunset Magazine did an article a couple summers ago on Pacific Coast Highway, and so it was all about Highway 1, and it starts off by saying that Highway 1 begins unceremoniously from a tangle of freeways in Dana Point, California. And it's not really until you hit Laguna Beach that you really feel like you're on Pacific Coast Highway. So we are looking forward to retelling that story, and we think this project can help us do that. Next slide, please. This is the Harbor Project. So this, we really only, there was a local coastal plan that had been adopted a while ago, and then we recently approved the coastal development permit. Next slide, please. You can see the boundaries of the LCP, and then the red area was the area that we were focusing on for the recent coastal development permit. So it's the land site improvements there, and you can see here's the site plan. Next slide, and here are some renderings of what this would look like. Next slide. Next slide. Next slide. So back on the harbor, the project is now, the County Board of Supervisors needs to determine how they're going to fund it. So they're estimating that it's a $120 million project. And so they're looking at sort of the existing cash flow and operational expenses. And they know that they're going to need to issue some bonds in order to pay for this. And that's going to be a political decision that needs to be made at the county board level. So they're progressing along. They're trying to figure that out. this was just the Gloria Day project, which has been approved. And I know that there's a groundbreaking ceremony coming up here in the not-too-distant future. So they are moving along with this project. This is a expansion to their current facility and upgrade. Next slide. You can see a few different elevations of the different buildings that are being proposed. Next slide. Ritz-Carlton, this was an expansion. They want to create a 15,200 square foot conference facility. They're going to do that on their existing tennis courts, which are underutilized, a few new rooms. This had come before the Planning Commission actually a few years ago, and then the banquet facility was the kind of the newer component that came to the Planning Commission more recently, and the Coastal Commission retains jurisdiction for issuing the coastal development permit. So this was just an approval in concept, and it has been approved by the Coastal Commission since then. So you can see a sort of a site plan. Next slide, here's some elevations of the new banquet facility. Next slide. This is South Shores Church. I won't spend too much time on this. You all got to see this very recently, but I will mention that, so your decision was appealed to the City Council. Keep clicking, Evan, please. And then the City Council's decision has been appealed to the Coastal Commission. We ascertained that it's not within the appeals jurisdiction, but the appellant is indicating that there's a wetland within 100 feet of the property, and he's claiming that the detention basin is a wetland. So Coastal's biologist is coming to visit the site this Friday, and they will make a determination of whether it's a wetland or not. The Coastal Act actually defines a wetland very broadly, and it doesn't define it the same way as some of the other regulatory agencies do that we're more used to dealing with on wetlands. So it will be interesting to see what determination they end up making. This is just a really small project over in Doheny Village, and there's a lot of interest in Doheny Village, so I include it. This is really the first, well, since I've been here in the past 2 years, the first project we've entitled in Doheny Village, and it's just a small office project, two stories. And
where is that in Doheny?
It's off of Las Vegas, so if you look here, let's see, is this Doheny Park Road? And so I can barely see this over here. So Las Vegas is like right here or something? Right here?
Right there.
It's behind me.
So.
Kind of behind the post office.
Post office.
Oh, okay.
Well, let's.
Yes.
Continue with the presentation. I don't want to keep interrupting
right.
You.
Next slide, please, Evan. So I think you already saw. And so that's all. And I don't expect really you all to have too many questions for me, but I can try to answer any except for projects that you will be deliberating on in the future. I want to avoid talking about those. And it was more just to give you a sense of all of the projects that have been major projects that have been coming before you. Obviously, the single family homes that you get a lot of, I don't include in this presentation, but I think that for if some of these projects actually get built, the ratio between sort of commercial and residential, you know, might start to shift a bit.
Well, that it makes me realize how many things we did in the last couple of years, and your department has done a phenomenal job in getting it through, you know. Because really, I think, you know, we're not going to recognize Dana Point in the next 5 years with all these wonderful projects coming before us, and some of the old is going to be, you know, wiped clean, and we'll have some new exciting development that is responsible and does our city proud, too. So I'm looking forward to all of that. Commissioner Claus?
Am I correct in that for confidentiality reasons, we cannot receive a copy of this presentation?
No, actually, I'm trying to get this presentation posted onto our website. It's just too large right now. We're having a hard time. It's too large of a file. But no, I can give it to any of you, and I've given it to all the real estate groups have asked me to give it to them, and like I said, we're trying to get it onto our website. I think we have an older version of it online, but I added more pictures, and that's what's making it such a large file.
Yeah, I think that would be very, very well appreciated by all of us, because there's a number of people who haven't seen any of those, and then there's a few of us who've been through all the whole process. So this would put us all on the same page. Thank you.
Any other questions for Ursula? No? Okay, well, any other staff reports? BevMo, did that get appealed?
It did not. It did not get appealed. Yes, and I don't know, John or Jen, if you have anything.
Nothing? Okay. So we'll go on to commissioner comments. Commissioner Claus?
I don't have any real comments. I mean, I think I was delighted by this meeting and the depth that we've gotten since, particularly like you and I, who have been through all of this for years and years and years and years.
And we've seen these pictures over and over and over again, and all of a sudden, wait a minute, these pictures are finally coming. It's a great feeling.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Commissioner McCann.
I seem to have an issue with building heights. So I'm wondering if I just need like a little individual study session or discussion with staff, or did we want to have a...
We're going to do a study session for on that topic. I just didn't want to pile up too much on one night. So
you're in defenses too.
We're looking, I think at the last, after the last meeting, there was an interest expressed in doing a workshop on building heights. And I think it's good because it's kind of complicated in certain areas, how we do it. And so we are looking this summer to schedule that. We're looking at our
okay.
agenda schedule.
And that's fine. I don't mean to be a problem child. we got the basement thing today, and I was like, okay, so the basement starts 10 feet up from the finished floor, but, I mean, where did that come from? And then I didn't want to stop or vote no on the barrel roof house, but to me that seems like a really, well, I don't quite know how it was ascertained that 6 and 12, just because it's 6 and 12 at the side, most of it is less than that, flatter than that, but I guess we'll get into it in the study session.
We can do a diagram to show how we calculate that.
That's good. We like visuals.
I do have one other question, sorry. On the Beach Roadhouse, so does that have to go to Coastal Commission now that we've approved it, or has it already gone? And
no, Beach Road, we have a certified local coastal plan, so we issue the coastal development permits, but it is within the appeals jurisdiction. So every time we issue a coastal development permit, we send the Coastal Commission staff a notice of final action, so they see the CDPs that get approved, and if it's in their appeals jurisdiction and they want to appeal it to the commission, they can.
Okay. How long is that appeals window?
How old are you?
Vice Chair Nelson.
Happy birthday. And I rode the trolley.
It's all right. Oh. And how was the trolley?
Great.
Okay.
That's
it. I rode the trolley too the whole way, did the circle, talked to so many interesting mm-hmm. people mm-hmm. That were getting on, and then the little surfers got on, and then the skateboarders got on. And it worked out great because some of the skateboarders got on lower down. And they came up Coast Highway, and then as we started down the El Prado, they hopped off so they could just shoot their way. It was really fun.
So you joined them in that pursuit.
And the kids looked like they thought this was a totally rad idea.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And then the only thing, you know, I'm all for the Concerts in the Park series, so I want to promote that. And last weekend it began, I believe. It was the first one. And then we've got all the way through
Actually,
August.
Yesterday was the first one.
Yeah.
Which I guess was last weekend, yeah.
Okay. The time's getting away from me. Although nobody's here other than us, but definitely go and see that. We're a very musical town with the Doheny Blues Festival and everything, so. All right, so adjournment. The next regular meeting of the Planning Commission will be held on Monday, July 27th, 2015, beginning at 6 p.m. or as soon thereafter in the City Council Chamber, located at 33282 Golden Lantern, Suite 210 in our musical and beautiful Dana Point, California. Good night.